I don't know where my preaching Bible is. I put it down somewhere. I don't have it, and I call it my preaching Bible. All my notes and all that. So if you have it, bring it back. All right, no questions asked. Yeah. I'm gonna tell you, I really do. I've been preaching out of ESV a little bit, but I love that King James, and it's hard for me to find the book of Genesis in this new Bible. I gotta tell you now, I'm laughing, but I'm a little anxious. I don't know where that Bible is, and so just pray for it, okay? So pray for us, okay? And we'll find out, guys. So someone just showed me this, and I don't say this to just be just another voice, you know, but I just want you to, there was a young lady applying to a college, Appalachian State University, and so the question is, how old are you? 19. What gender are you? And under that, non-binary, multigender, gender fluid, a gender, no gender, male, female, gender queer, prefer not to say, prefer to self-describe. So like this is where man's wisdom ultimately leads him. Right? So this is what we've been kind of like talking about, the wisdom of this world, which we live in this world. It's always shifting in this world based on relativity, trends, not truth. Consensus, popularity, all these things is what determines what's right and wrong in man's thinking. And it is absolutely the best he can do apart from divine truth. It's the best that any of us can do apart from divine truth. I've said it about me, and I know it is true about you. How quickly I get pudgy or soft in my perception, my clarity, how vivid things begin to become a little vague. And how quickly that happens when I spend any time away from the Word of God. I wish I could tell you it was different. I wish I could tell you I'm made out of better stuff. I'm not. I get away from the Word of God in any length of time, and I get pudgy. You know what I'm talking about? Get soft on the edges. The best we can do apart from the Word of God. Because we're left ourselves. There is a way that seems right unto man. Right? It's the frivolity of it. The futility of it. And the fatality of it. It's the way that leads to death. And so the thing that we've been talking about is about being wise, but a wisdom that comes from the Word, not the world. And this verse that you ought to have underlined, ought to have marked if you don't, and it's 1 Corinthians 3:19, I think, yeah, that the wisdom of this world is foolishness to God, right? So, like, we can be wise according to this world, but it is foolishness to God. And God, the Bible says, takes the wise of this world at their own craftiness. That is, our own way of thinking, our own cleverness will be used like a booby trap. Isn't it the art of judo where your weight is used against you? It's always using your weight and where you, and so our natural tendencies, our wisdom that comes apart from the word, a wisdom of the world, will be used against us. So it's a scary thing to reject divine revelation for human reason. And that's in the 1 Corinthians 3:19. 1 Corinthians 3:19. So and verse 18 says, hey, listen, if you think you are wise, if you think that you are wise in this world, become a fool so that you might really be wise. In other words, the wisdom from the word is counterintuitive. So what you have to do is jettison that and take God's word for what wisdom is. Not rely upon yourself, because you will be self-deceived. Right? Hey, listen. Selfishness and all of the things that come from just selfishness, self-delusion and self-advancement and self-preservation, self, right? The biggest problem in the world is self. And because I am so selfish, I am easily self-deceived, because I'll tell myself lies all day. It's true. Selfishness is our factory setting. Right? It's default. It really is. These little fingers curl inward. And I see the world according to me. It's natural. Right? That'll never change. But what needs to change is me. So that the me that sees the world sees it through the prism of the word of God and not my own human reason. Right? I see things as I am, not as they are. I need to be changed so that I can see the way they are. Yeah. So he says, don't be a fool. He says, if you're wise in this world, become a fool by this world's measure, by this world's, so that you might really be a wise person, a wisdom that is a superlative wisdom as high as the heavens are above the earth. So are God's ways and thoughts above our ways and thoughts. This is wisdom from the word, his wisdom from the world. We have this factory default or factory setting that sees it my way and thinks about it my way. And the fool is the person who rejects this wisdom and opts for human reasoning. And this is just what it leads to. Confusion, confusion, confusion. It's sad. Because my children, your children, have to live in this world and they have to fight through this kind of an application. Did you notice that? How old are you? 19, I know that, right? You can't say, well, I feel 27 today. You see what I'm saying? You see how? You've lied about being 21 before, I know, but... But I'm just saying, why is that? There is no subjectivity with age. I'm 19. I'm not 27 because I want to be 27 or feel 27 or feel like I'm 3 or I prefer not to say. But this is confusion. And what I'm saying, guys, What is true about the world in general is true about you. Amen. Apart from the word of God. Amen. right? So that, you remember, I think I can be walking. Wisdom is precarious, it's precious. She's spoken of as a woman in the feminine. It can be offended, her feelings can be hurt, and you can keep on walking, and she's back there. Not so knowledge. Knowledge will walk with you. A lot of knowledge is informational, and we men, we love information, but you can know a lot of stuff and be a fool. Amen. Wisdom is precarious. And you can walk in wisdom right here in this step and be a fool the next step. When you do what, guys? What have we been talking about? When you opt for human reasoning in this next step rather than divine revelation. Rather than what God says. So the Bible says, walk in wisdom. Right? Ephesians 5, we need to walk in wisdom. And walk is pedestrian. It's day by day, deed by deed, decision by decision, step by step, every day, all the time, always. Walk in wisdom. It's granular, step by step. So when the question is, who is wise among us? That's the question. That's where all this started in James 5:13. Who's wise among us? Well, wisdom is known by the fruit that she bears. Her children bear her witness. So am I a wise man? Am I walking according to divine revelation? Or am I walking in my own way? Am I walking in the way of Cain? Remember? So that's how we got on Cain. The Bible talks about the person, the apostate in Jude 11, as being the person who is walking according to the way of Cain. They're walking like Balaam, but they're walking like Cain. Balaam was a mercenary missionary, but Cain was the original fool in the Bible. The original rebel, the original person who says, I really don't care what God says, I'm going to do it my way. I don't care what God says to bring, I'm going to bring what I want to bring. The Bible says his deeds were evil. So he grew up in a house where he knew what to do, and maybe his mom and dad saw him grow up and they see that foolishness in him, right? That's bound in the heart of a child that has to be driven out. And the Bible says to us, in God's dear name, don't raise a fool. They'll break your heart. Amen. They'll break their mama's heart. Mm-hmm. It'll cause you to weep bitter, warm tears in your pillow. A fool who cannot be told, who will not be told, who will not hear the truth, who will not submit to revelation, divine revelation, what's right, what's wrong, will not submit to that. That is a fool. And so, where is James in this Bible here? Let's see here. Let's go to James. I'm gonna read this list. This is, it's still out of Hebrews here, all right? James chapter number 3, where he talks about these fools and he says, "Who?" Verse 13, are you there now? He says, now who is wise and understanding among you? That's where this whole thing got started, right? Who is a wise man among us? Who is wise? Right? And I want to shoot my hand up. Ooh, 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 right? But then, because he begins to describe the wise man. It begins to describe what wisdom looks like. It's a character thing. And by the way, not only talks about wisdom, it talks about the fool. The fool is the person who is wise according to this world. Well, we are encouraged not to be wise according to this world. Become a fool to this world so that you might really have wisdom that comes from the word. So it's so counterintuitive and it's so, it's just so out with the world. So notice he says, By his good conduct, let him show his works. Now listen, wisdom is evident by how we live. Don't get to thinking because I'm a little, you know, you clever or crafty or savvy or you got old noodle. You know, I'm talking about all of these things. You can mentally muscle through things in this world, and that makes a wise man. Not so. By his good life, good conduct, let him show his works in meekness of wisdom. All right? So now, again, there's another thing about wisdom right now. It tells us right now that wisdom is not bombastic. Wisdom doesn't push its way to the front. Wisdom doesn't say, pay attention to me. Wisdom doesn't say, this is how wise I am. Knowledge does. Knowledge wants you to know how smart it is. Knowledge puffs up, and knowledge says, hey, I'm the smartest guy in the room. Right? Wisdom doesn't do that. Wisdom, no, it doesn't have to. There's a meekness that goes along with wisdom. Amen. So before I shoot my hand up, I have to ask, am I a meek person? Am I, you know, the idea of meekness is not like a puppy dog. Not, you know, someone has said meekness is not weakness. If you think meekness is weakness, try being meek for a week. You find out it's not weakness. It is a strength that is harnessed. It is a strength brought under control. It is like a horse that has been broken, not hobbled, broken. And it's as strong as it ever was, but it's under control. So wisdom doesn't scream and shout about how much it knows. Knowledge does, right? Knowledge is proud because it knows so much. Wisdom is humble because it realizes it knows so little. And that education is the process of learning how much you don't know. We don't know a percent of 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 what there is to know. How foolish are we? Right? And knowledge just puffs up. Paul said that. That's a truism. That is one of these basic truths in life, right? That you just, it does. It does in me. It does in you. When you know something other people don't know, you know what, you learn something. Well, I don't care whether it's in church or whether it's in school, wherever you know something other people, there's a little tendency. You know what I'm saying? That knows to go up. And it happens in spiritual circles as much as it happens anywhere else. I mean, there's a lot of spiritual snobs walking around. Because they're better T-crossers than our daughters than everybody else. And they know this and they know that. Right? And God hates it. He hates that. Wherever. So wisdom. Are y'all following me now here? So he says wisdom. And then he says, now, look, if there's bitter jealousy and selfish ambition. Remember what I said, the biggest problem in the world is selfishness. There's not one sin I've ever thought or spoke or did or contemplated or guilty of that is not some way, shape, or form connected to selfishness. And the Bible says in Philippians 2, 3, let nothing be done through selfish ambition. Or conceit. It's how the ESV says it. Selfish ambition or conceit. You know, the disease that makes everybody sick but the person who has it. Let nothing be done by selfish ambition. Now, you know what nothing is? Nothing is the opposite of everything. And everything I do, basically, is out of selfish ambition and conceit. Remember, this is the factory setting for the natural man. I had a chaplain that speak at our church on Sunday, did a great job. One of the things he says, you'll never have to say to somebody, now, Odell, listen, this is going to be hard, but listen, I want you to, I know this is going to be hard, but I want you to spend some time today just thinking about yourself. Right? I know it's going to be tough now. Listen, please, just do that. Fight off all things and then spend some time, quality time, just thinking about yourself. You don't have to do that. Tell nobody that. That's all we think about. Even the people who fancy themselves as being humble, that number pride turned upside down. It's still self-thought. Me, me, me. How low I am. How bad I am. It's me. So he says, look, real faith shows itself in conduct. And then he says, listen, so these people that he's addressing, no doubt, fancied themselves as being wise people. But then he's saying, okay, now, he's like a good old doctor who puts his finger on something. You say, doctor, I got a problem right here. You know what the doctor's going to do? He's going to push on that thing. Ooh. And James puts his finger right on some stuff to say, hey, look, don't be thinking you're so wise and all these things are evident in your life. What are they? If you have bitter jealousy, that's a question. This is not just for people long ago and far away. This is a November the 12th, 2021 deal with the guys at the Band of Brothers. We're a band of brothers. This is for us. All right? Not just long ago, far away. Is there bitter jealousy in this room today? Right? And selfish ambition in your heart? Just elbow to forget about you, right? I love me. And family is just the opposite. F-A-M-I-L-Y, forget about me, I love you. Right? And if that was like the mantra that we live by and it was really the truth in this room, we really would be a band of brothers. If that was what I lived by at my home would be heaven on earth. Right? If a church had that, it'd be sweeter than honey in the honeycomb. Forget about me. Right? Like how low can you go? Fight for the bottom. The Bible says, let each esteem others or consider others as being better than yourself. Not even equal to yourself, better than yourself. You see how counterintuitive that is? When all I think about is me, myself, and I had a little tea party one afternoon at 3:00. It was very small, 3 guests in all, just I, myself, and me. Myself ate all the sandwiches. I drank all the tea. It was also I who ate the pie and passed the cake to me. The me, myself, and I party. And that so loves me that I'm jealous of anybody who's a step in front of me, who's advanced a little faster than me, who drives something newer than me, who earns a bigger salary than me, who's happier than me, who's this, that, and the other, and it just eats you up, and it's bitter, and it's burning a hole in your belly. Uh-huh. was talking to a man one day, and he was saying to me, my neighbor, he, that young punk, he's got everything. And he was telling me, I mean, can't you see him like Miss Kravitz on Bewitched, you know, looking out the window? And that guy comes up, and he doesn't appreciate anything. You know, his old man owns that blood over there, and so he doesn't care about anything. He comes up in something new every day. And I just listened to the guy, and you know what he was in? He just peeved at this guy because he had a lot of stuff. It ain't like the guy's, you know, throwing stuff on his lawn or encroaching upon him or being a bad neighbor. He just had more stuff. And he said, look at that joke. He doesn't care about anything. You get that. I said, that's bitter envy, right? Yeah, I don't have an axe to grind with this guy. Right? But this is, so now notice, so and you can have all these things and still by the world standard be wise. And James says, not so with God. So he says, if you've got bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your heart, do not boast. Don't be walking around like you are wise, boasting that you are wise, no matter what the world says. It may be savvy. It may be business smarts. It may be you use your old noodle. It may be all these things that the world, and by the way, the world loves that. The world applauds that. And the world, that's great by the world standard. Right? And you may have advanced. And hey, listen, the way the world, you know, this is capital in this world. Moves you forward in this world system. But he says, don't boast and be false to the truth. See, self-deception and delusion is when you're false to the truth. Amen. When the truth is spoken, the truth is God's divine revelation. And then watch, the truth is revealed, and the truth then is rejected, and then the truth is rethought, and then the truth is replaced. And that's when you hear people say today, well, my truth is this. You ever hear that? Y'all hear that talk today? This is my truth. It's been revealed, the truth has been revealed, but it's been rejected, it's been rethought, and now it's replaced. Amen. Read Romans 1, 17 and following. That's the process. The revelation of the truth, the rejection of the truth, the rethinking of the truth, and the replacing the truth of God with a lie. And so when you ask, what sex are you? There are 13 things to pick from. But it's the best that man can do. This is not the wisdom that comes from above. It says it right here. That is not the wisdom that comes from above. But it is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. That is of the world, the flesh, and the devil. And he gives us this truism. For wherever jealousy and selfish ambition exists, there will be disorder in every vile practice. There's a lot of other stuff goes along with that. And then he says, but the wisdom from above. So wisdom from the world, and then this superlative wisdom from above. I'm closing here in just a minute. The wisdom that comes from God, the wisdom that is revealed from God in Christ. Right? Who has made unto us wisdom and sanctification, righteousness and redemption. That's who Christ is. So this wisdom, the divine truth revealed from heaven, this is who Christ is. So a person who is wise in this world, who does not embrace Christ, is not wise after all. He says here, the wisdom that is from above is, and then he describes it, it's pure, right? It's gentle. It's, the King James says, reasonable. It's open to reason. Now, if I were to take all of these things here that it's talking about, full of mercy and good fruits and partial and sincere, right? All of these things, which make up, by the way, a harvest of righteousness. But notice this. If I were to take all these things, and I look back over in the book of Proverbs, you'll hear the wise man talk about what wisdom looks like in the fool. And the fool is none of these things. So like, for instance, open to reason. Remember what we said about a fool? A fool's not open to reason. Right? A fool is a person who rejects reason, real reason. And God says, hey, come, let us what? Reason together. God intends, God has given us, he's made us above the brute beast. And he reveals truth to us and holds us responsible for what we do with that truth. And you're going to either receive truth or you're going to reject truth. Real wisdom is a person that's open to reason. And a person like Cain, God tried to reason with him. If you do good, you'd be accepted. Cain wasn't open to reason. And a person who's not open to reason, you know I'm talking about, you work with them, right? You may be sitting next to one, right? I know you're not one, but a person who's not open, right? Present company accepted, right? A person who's not open to reason is a fool. And that can, watch this, that can be a preacher, that can be a plumber, or that can be a president. I don't care who you are. You're not open to reason? That's a fool. Yeah. So we'll take up on Cain. You know, when God saved us, I'm here closing here, but when God saved us, he says to us, he says, listen, he says that Jesus said over and over, he that hath an ear to hear, let him hear. So it's like a dog whistle to the wise, right? Right? The fool doesn't hear. It's like it's a different frequency. He hears what he wants to hear. Jesus says, he that hath an ear to hear, let him hear. It's like this is a word to the wise. And wisdom, you know what the reward of wisdom is? Wisdom. If you're wise enough to hear, God will give you more wisdom. And he calls us to this and he demands it of us, but he supplies it to us. I said he demands it of us. He demands wisdom of us, but he supplies it to us. Right? He always does. Everything he supplies, everything he requires, he supplies. So I can be a wise man, He gives me divine revelation on how to walk in this world. And I become a foolish man and can be today. The opportunities abound today for me to be a fool. I've got to learn today to bridle brother ass. I got a jackass in me. I got a stubborn disposition in me, and that's got to be bridled. And I've got to obey God every step. And God holds us responsible to it. Let's pray. Father, we're thankful today for the great privilege to have an opportunity and time to pull aside, eat a good breakfast, and enjoy music that makes us think, and then to have your word open before us, God, and to learn from your word. But God, in this very passage out of James, you say, let us be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving ourselves. So easy to deceive ourselves. So help us to be wise, wise indeed now, because we obey your word. It's the wisest thing we can do is obey. And teach us that. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Just in perfect men, a broken home.